Hi everyone, I am very happy to welcome you all to Dr. JJS Virtual Academy of Commerce. In this video, I am going to take you through an exercise, a very interesting exercise from the chapter Ratio Analysis. Let's get into the problem. From the following details, prepare a balance sheet with as much details as possible. The given information are stock velocity 6 times, which is nothing but stock turnover ratio. Capital turnover ratio is equal to 2 times. Fixed assets turnover ratio is equal to 4 times. Gross profit ratio is 20%. Debtors velocity 2 months. Creditors velocity 73 days. The gross profit was 60,000 rupees and reserves and surplus amount to 20,000 rupees. Other current assets were amounted 16,500. Closing stock was 5,000 rupees in excess of opening stock. These are all the information given in the problem, based on which we need to prepare a balance sheet with as much details as possible. Now you look at the problem to know where to start. It is good that we start with the gross profit ratio, because we are given with the GP ratio and the gross profit amount. So if you come to know gross profit amount, you can very well make use of the same to calculate sales. If you come to know sales value, you can very well find out the cost of goods sold. This is a plan. Now let's start. Gross profit ratio is equal to 20%. If gross profit is 20%, amounted 60,000 rupees, sales with 100% weightage is nothing but 3 lakhs. So 60,000 divided by 20 into 100, it will give you 3 lakh rupees. So when gross profit is 60,000 rupees and the percent of the same on sales is 20%, what is the value of sales? Sales with a weightage of 100% will be equal to 3 lakh rupees. Now, if you know sales and gross profit, you can very well calculate the cost of goods sold. Cost of goods sold is equal to sales minus gross profit. So 3 lakh minus 60,000, it gives you 2 lakh 40,000 rupees of cost of goods sold. Now, let us make use of the stock velocity. Here it is given in terms of times, therefore it is stock turnover ratio. What is the formula? Cost of goods sold divided by average stock is equal to 6 by 1, because you are informed that it is of 6 times, so 6 by 1. So if cost of goods sold with the weight of 6 is equal to 2,40,000, average stock with the weight of 1 is equal to 40,000 rupees. 2,40,000 divided by 6 into 1, it gives us what? 40,000 rupees. That is the value of average stock. We were informed that the closing stock is 5,000 rupees more than the opening stock. That should be kept in mind. Now, what is average stock? Average stock is nothing but the total of opening and closing stock divided by 2. Therefore, with the help of the average stock and this additional information, we can very well calculate the value of closing stock and opening stock. Closing stock is equal to average stock plus 50% of the difference between the closing and opening stock. Why I add 50% of the difference? Because closing stock is more than the opening stock by 5,000. That is why here I add the 50% difference with the average stock. When I go to calculate opening stock, here I will deduct 50% of the difference between opening and closing. This is the logic. Okay, 40,000 rupees plus 50% difference of the 5,000 rupees, it is nothing but 2,500. So the total is what? 42,500. That's the value of closing stock. Now, what is the value of opening stock? Average stock minus 50% of the difference. There you deduct the 50% difference. So it comes to 37,500. Now let us move to make use of the fixed asset turnover ratio. Cost of goods sold divided by fixed assets. You better take cost of goods sold in the turnover ratios. Only in debtors velocity ratio you can take the sales figure. Please make it very clear.
Right. Cost of goods sold divided by fixed assets is equal to 4/1. Because they said it is 4 times. If cost of goods sold 4 is equal to 2,40,000 rupees, what is the value of fixed assets with a value of 1? Fixed assets is equal to 2,40,000 divided by 4 into 1. It gives us 60,000 rupees. That's the value of fixed assets. Now let us move to make use of the next ratio, that's debtors velocity. What is the formula for calculating debtors velocity? If you make use of the months, you can say 12 months divided by credit sales into average accounts receivable. In the absence of information related to opening accounts receivable, which are none other than the opening debtor and opening bills receivable, you can very well replace the average accounts receivable with just accounts receivable at the end. That's closing accounts receivable. Fine. Now, what about credit sales? You can assume that in the absence of information about cash sales and credit sales, the total sales could be treated as credit sales. That's what I have done here. So 2 is debtors velocity in terms of months is equal to 12 divided by 3 lakhs into accounts receivable. Now you retain the accounts receivable there. Now 2 into 3 lakhs divided by 12. The 12 will become the denominator using cross multiplication. The answer is 50,000 rupees. So what is the value of accounts receivable? 50,000. Do you know how much of the 50,000 is debtor and how much is bills receivable? That you can't calculate because you don't have adequate information to find out the proportion between debtor and bills receivable in this figure. You keep it as it is. Next, we move to make use of the next ratio, which is nothing but creditors velocity. Since creditors velocity is given in terms of days, year, 73 days, the formula is 365 days divided by credit purchase into average accounts payable. In the absence of information related to opening accounts payable of the business, you can very well write closing accounts payable. In the place of average accounts payable, what you can write? Closing accounts payable. What about purchase? After you calculate purchase, you can assume the total purchase as credit purchase because there is no information about cash purchase and credit purchase in the problem. Now let us first calculate purchase. To calculate purchase, we need to make use of a very, very popular formula. What is that? Think of the trading account and its format related to the T form of trading account. In the debit side, you find opening stock and purchase. You add the two. Opening stock plus purchase. And go to the credit side. You find sales. Just ignore it. Because we would like to calculate only cost of goods sold. What is the other one? Closing stock. So opening stock plus purchase minus closing stock will give you cost of goods sold. This is a formula. Now you rearrange the formula according to the requirement. We don't want to calculate cost of goods sold in this problem because we know it is 2,40,000 rupees. We know opening stock is amounted 37,500. Closing stock is amounted 42,500. Then what is it we do not know out of the four items that appear in the formula? We do not know purchase. Therefore, how we rearrange the formula? Purchase is equal to cost of goods sold minus opening stock plus closing stock. So 2,40,000 minus 37,500 plus 42,500. What is that? You get 2,45,000. That's the value of a purchase. In the absence of information about credit and cash purchase, you are allowed to assume that the total purchase is what? Credit purchase. Let's make use of creditors velocity now. 365 days divided by 2,40,000 credit purchase into accounts payable is equal to what? 73 days. Therefore, accounts payable is equal to 73 into 2,45,000 divided by 365. You get 49,000 rupees as the value of accounts payable. Since you don't know adequate information about the bills payable or creditors, you leave accounts payable as it is. You can place it as it is in the balance sheet liability side. The next ratio we have to make use is nothing but capital turnover ratio. Cost of goods sold divided by capital. Here they refer, I understand, proprietary fund. Because we are informed about the value of reserves and surplus, it's amounted 20,000. Therefore, I assume in this place that it is proprietary fund. Fine. So cost of goods sold divided by proprietary fund or capital is equal to 2/1, because they said it is 2 times. Now, if cost of goods sold with the weight of 2 is equal to 2,40,000, the capital or proprietary fund with the weight of 1 is equal to 1,20,000. How it is computed? It is computed this way. Yes, 2,40,000 divided by 2 into 1, it gives us 1,20,000 rupees. That's the value of a capital or proprietary fund. Now, let's have a look at the balance sheet, what I have prepared. Liabilities and capital, on the other side is titled assets. Since they said reserves and surplus is amounted 20,000 rupees, how I have done it? Please have a look at it. Proprietary fund, 1,20,000. We know reserves and surplus, 20,000. Therefore, the balance is what? Named to be share capital. Fine. In addition to that, what is the other item that would be placed in the balance sheet? There is no long-term liability. But we calculated one current liability, which is nothing but accounts payable. You write the name of accounts payable with a value of 49,000. Have you found any other item of liability? No. Up to my knowledge, there is no other item related to liability given in the problem. Move to the assets side. Fixed assets we calculated. The fixed assets we calculated, it is amounted how much? 60,000 rupees. Accounts receivable we calculated, that is also amounted how much? 50,000 rupees. In addition to that, we calculated closing stock. Then we were informed about the other current assets valued 16,500 in the problem. Do we have any other item that will appear in the asset side of the balance sheet other than fixed assets, accounts receivable, closing stock and other current assets? Absolutely no other item is available with regard to asset side. So now let's close the balance sheet. You find the balance sheet is tallied with 1,69,000 either side. This is a very interesting problem. I suggest you, the learners, to watch this video as many times as required for you to understand the concept thoroughly. Thanks for your time to watch this video. I'll meet you in another video. Bye for now, everyone.